citizens.
So when you compute the difference between the wrong case and the correct case to show that you get a minus, what is the precise case where you use the fact that so you get the bonus, so you get the derivative at some point.
But
so what I mean is that at which place you use that you have this difference, because it seems that one of the terms cancels.
Oh, because the point is otherwise, if you want to write this cube with I of two, it has to be in the large. Taller you are going in the large.
Yeah, so I say, and if you want to have the small, you need the difference between x and I. So it's at this point that you use this size.
Yeah, because it's only when you have the difference that you can use it for charge conservation, etc., that hold for the small number space. Right? Otherwise, you have to reinterpret this as a calculation in the large number space. Yeah, and there things are a bit more complicated.
Okay. So you need just this difference, even if one term cancels, you need still to get it.
Yeah, so you have to keep in mind that you are actually talking about a difference. Okay, so today we will complete the task that we began, okay, which is to look for the secret value. Okay. So let me remind you what we had gotten so far. So we computed the solution. So we wrote psi as a partial expansion. I called it from what is important is we define psi k sum over n equal to 1 to k g s to the k g s to the n, okay, that's truncated to order k g s to the k, and then we started computing the psi k's by iterative means, and what we found is that we computed up to second order, and psi 2 was given by the following formula. So this is a leading order seed solution, and then we had the order ks square contribution, if I put this half yesterday in the formula, but this half essentially comes from the 1 over n minus 1.
The 1 minus p.
Yeah, so 1 minus p was there, but then I said that the p acting on this gives you 0 in this special case. So I can just replace the 1 minus p by 1. Okay, otherwise there will be 1 minus p. If this had any component around the L0 plus equal to 0 states, then this is indefinite, right? Because there is an L0 plus equal to. But here things simplify that to this order you don't have to worry about this 1 minus p, because this has no component other than the L0 plus 1 plus 0 space. So now we want to go to the next order. So for the next order, the equation that we want to solve is q to psi k is minus contribution, I'll call GS times psi tilde 1. Okay, this psi tilde 1 is the same as psi. Okay, so I could have written this as psi tilde n. And this I'll call GS square times psi tilde. So psi tilde at the contribution to at that order. Okay. Order GS contribution is calling GS cycle layer 1, or GS square contribution is what I'm calling GS square cycle layer 2. So cycle layer 2 is what I'm multiplied by GS square. So now, let's expand it out. So here you have GS cycle number 1 plus GS square cycle number 2 to the power n minus 1. And now you have to collect terms up to order GSK. So let's first collect terms of order GS square. This of course you have already done earlier, but let's do it anyway. So the order GS square you have minus half GS square psi 1 tilde square 0. Okay, that is the one contribution to order GS square. And then there are another contribution which is minus G square. Then we look at the order GS cube contribution. So one term is minus 1/6 GS cube cycle number 1 cube. Can I just expand it up? N minus 1 equals 3. Then there is another contribution minus GS cube cycle number 1 cycle number 2. So this is coming from the n equal to 3 term. N minus 1 is equal to 2. When you square it, there is a term, cross term, gs psi 1 tilde, gs square psi tilde 2. So that gives you psi tilde 1, psi tilde 2, and the 2 cancels the 1 over 2, which you have
calculated. The last term.
Pardon?
The last term,
yes, so that the cross product, the 2, cycle the 1, cycle the 2, that 2 will come, can cancel the 1 part. Where is the n minus 1 equal to 3. And to this order, this is the all the contributions that we get from the 3 level, I think. And then there is a term minus GS2. So this, we have to solve this equation. Okay, one will actually not try to solve it. Okay. We'll test the consistency condition. Okay, under what condition can we solve this equation? And that we have seen that the condition is that we have Pc0 minus Qb psi 3 equal to 0 for every physical state. So P. And this means that P C0 minus right hand side should be 0. Okay, why right hand side is this? Is this clear? So let us now see what we get on the right hand side. So the first term minus 1/6 C0 minus times this is nothing but a particle. Okay, as you have reminded you that P0 minus, so this is already 0 that we have checked at the previous order. Okay, so we don't have to check anything. Order g squared, otherwise you couldn't have gotten the order g squared contribution solution, right? So the fact that P0 minus on this is 0, that actually follows because in each term individual vanishes, right? That's what I said last time. So that is the first term. Second term, so I am not going to use these GS cube terms. The GS cube, of course, is a common factor which I get out. So this gives you P psi 1 tilde minus. Psi 1 tilde is just beta times sigma. Okay, and psi 2 tilde is this complicated combination. So this gives you actually the minus I can just move to be part of the plus. Okay, because the minus side is common. So the first term is 1/6 beta cube E nu cube. Plus P psi 1 tilde psi 2 tilde. Psi 1 tilde puts as a beta and what? Psi 2 tilde is more complicated. Okay, it has several terms. So let me write this. There is an extra minus sign now because psi 2 tilde has a minus, right? Psi 2 tilde comes with a minus sign. So why does one term will be beta? U0 plus, and then let me do both terms, half beta square and U1 So we have to expand it out. So 1/6 W P Okay, now we are trying to going to interpret this. Is it okay so far? Right, I have just expanded out part of what I was telling that. So let's look at this now. Instead of trying to reduce all the terms of one go, let me try to look at the second term. So the second term I can write by inserting a complete set of states. So if I write as a P V bar, I'll insert a complete set of states in between. So that is phi bar. Then phi bar C. Okay, let me explain how it happens. So this is a state, right? E0 plus over M0 plus nu r g equal to 0. This is the state in the hyperspace. So this state I just write. So all I have done is that I have written E0 plus over L0 plus nu r g equal to 0 as phi r c. Okay, sum over complete set of states, so this is identity operator. Okay, so you get back that state. Okay. So this term, phi r, is what we have left. P nu r phi r. Okay, because this whole state I have just replaced by phi r. And then the coefficient of expansion is what we have left. Now, phi r is analyzed by V0 minus. Then it's a basic states in the Hilbert space, because after all these are all analyzed by V0 minus from by definition. Okay? So phi r is analyzed by V0 minus, which means phi r c is analyzed by C0 minus. Okay? So because it's analyzed by C0 minus, I can insert a V0 minus C0 minus here. Because C0 minus, okay, when you pass it through, the anticomputer will just be 1. And when it's on the other side, it analyzes phi r c. Because phi r c is not minus c0. So I can insert V0 minus C0 minus. Is this okay? And then I insert here for that another complex set of resistance, I s c phi s. So what you get is P nu r phi r this of course is nothing but phi s. this here. Okay. So this now you can say has a nice interpretation. This is a 3-point vortex, pre-Newark fire. This is a propagator. And this is again a 3-point vortex, IS Newark Newark. So this is essentially represented in the diagram. All zero.
This here. What do we do with C zero minus C zero?
Because the definition of this curly bracket is that there is a C zero minus here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I guess reinterpreting this as the curly bracket. Because the point of I is added by V zero minus, so this is non-zero only inside C zero minus. Pardon? Yeah, because all of these, see, new R by definition carries zero momentum, right? So new R is a vortex operator, the zero momentum external vortex.
Absolutely.
Okay? Because that's what you have switched on. Right? You don't want to break transition, right? So you are switching on zero momentum vortex operator. So these are all zero momentum states. Yeah, so as by momentum conservation, P loss of zero momentum. Okay. So typically a diagram like this may have divergence because if there is a massless state, for example, right? So there is 1/k², right? In case k equal to 0, that will be divergent. Okay. Here it doesn't happen precisely because of this fact that P newer is 0. Okay. That means that in the newer 3-point function, right, there is no massless state here, no L0 + 0 state, which has a non-zero 3-point function in newer. And that's why this is a perfectly sensible graph. Yeah. Otherwise, of course, you would automatically have a 1-1 SP here. Yeah. Okay. So that L0 + 0 contribution have to be subtracted out. That has to be treated separately. Okay, but in this case, that complication doesn't arise. Things are reasonably straightforward. Some of these terms. Okay. So term 1 plus term 2. This is 1/6 beta cube. This is the 1-particle irreducible vortex of 1p and 4 dr at 3 level. So this is p dr plus 3 times p dr. These are all the g equal to 0 vortices. These vortices are all the unparted vortices, right? Because you are not using a time object anymore. You have all expired. So these are all in the unparted, in the parted time. Okay. So you see some interpretation of this sum? These are total 4-point amplitude. Okay. E new and new and. Right. What is the factor of field wind here? STL internal diagram. Right? Here the STL internal diagram all contribute the same because they all the external momentum of the zero momentum and all the other identical. Right? Three of the four external legs are identical. So STL internal together gives you this factor of 3. So this I can write as gamma 4 is a 4-point function g equal to 0 of p d1. I should have said the minus sign actually got if you just follow the definition of the proper integral, you can see that the minus sign is the correct one. There's an extra minus sign, right? The second term is a minus sign. But it's only after including the minus sign that you get it. Okay, similarly, you can check that the term 3 and 4 term 4 already has a simple interval. These are two point functions at genus t, at genus 1, right? The first term as I interpret it, this is g equal to 0 for this, this is g equal to 1 for this. The second one, okay, you can see that this is g equal to 1 for this, because again, you insert p, nu or phi s, and the three point function, three level three point function, because this is g equal to 0. So that's this vortex over here. Then you have a proper integral. And then this will represent phi s one part function. Yeah, that's that vortex over here. So this I can write as gamma 2 g equal to 1. So using this, I can write this equation as 1/6 beta cube gamma 4 plus beta this is g equal to 1. Okay, all the GS factors have been taken out.
Sir, your interpret is this way, let's see, looking at the terms.
Yes.
From the field theory perspective, field theory perspective, you also expect this.
Yeah, from the field theory perspective, what is happening is that the point is, from the field theory perspective, you can think of this, if you have integrated out all the other things. This is like a four-point coupling. And this one is at 2-point coupling, but the 4-point coupling is at 3 level, 2-point coupling is at 1 loop level, the full effective action, and then you are trying to extremize it. Okay? So if you extremize it, the 4-point coupling will come to 1 over 24, right? 1 over 4 factorial. Right? So to differentiate, right, it's a high 4 kind of coupling, so there will be a factor of 4 coming down from, yeah, that gives a 1/6. Right? 2-point coupling will be half phi square, and when you differentiate it, it will be the half factor will be cancelled. Right? So that way you can also see that this comes to there. This 1/6 factor comes up. But there is one difference. In field theory, you extremize the one-way effective action, right? Not the full four-point function. You are extremizing the full four-point function. Right? And the reason that you can do this is because on the intermediate state, right, no massless state propagates. Right? We are including terms like this. You are including terms like this in the contribution to this action, but no massless states contribute. Right? So including terms like this effectively means that you are integrating out all the weight fields. Right? And writing down an effective theory of massless fields, and then you are taking the derivative with respect to the massless fields. So in this field theory analysis, that is automatically done by this solving the equation. Right? It's not that you have to first separate out the heavy field and light field and integrate out. Right, the full string field equation is almost automatically gives this.
In case of normal
Yes, so if you had only massless field, then you would have only got this. Okay. This would not be there. Okay. Because at 1 minus p, basically remove this. Okay. Here 1 minus p doesn't remove anything. Okay. Because there are no massless fields propagating. And massive fields have to be included anyway because you are trying to integrate them all. Okay, so now what one can show, okay, again this requires a detailed analysis in the CFT, that the only P that gives non-trivial condition is P equal to R. See, in general, there will be, for every P you will get a constant. And for every physical state you will get a constant. Right? So, by adjusting one coefficient, you cannot satisfy all constants in general. Right? But that of course can be compensated for by the fact that you have chosen not to introduce any other coefficient. Right? You could have started with a classical solution, which is a linear combination of all possible physical states. Right? We have taken only nu r and started with that. We have done it on the hindsight that we can actually solve it because only one state contributes here. Right? For all other states, basically, each term vanishes separately. Right? So there is a constant on here. But when you choose P with P equal to mu 1, then one finds that these don't vanish identically, these are non zero. And this means that you can satisfy this only for some special choice. So at this level, now beta gets fixed. Pardon? One solution is beta equal to 0. Okay? That's a part of a de facto. Okay? But there are other solutions which are two other beta plus minus. So you get solution, three solutions. Important point here is that the beta naught is here. Okay? Which is the statement that gamma 2 So once we have gotten satisfied this, then all consistency conditions are now satisfied, and you can explicitly construct psi.
One of the argument of Kamakur should be P, right? Not all four are
equal. But the point is that this is the only P that contributes is P equal to D1.
Oh,
yes. Okay. That's why the beta is determined from these two. All identical external states. Okay. If you put P to be anything other than D1, then each vanishes separately. Okay. So there is no, it doesn't give any constant.
Can I just repeat once again why they should have opposite signs?
Because if this has to vanish, right? You see that beta square, so one solution is beta equal to 0.
Yeah.
The other one is beta square equal to minus, square root of minus 6 gamma 2 over now. Right?
Right.
So if they don't have opposite sign, then the beta will be imaginary.
I see.
Right? But beta has to be real because beta multiplies a real vortex of part. Right? So this would correspond to having a solution, an imaginary solution, right?
Right.
Which is a formal solution, but it's not a physical solution of the. Right? It's like you have mod phi square in the previous example, right? Mod phi square, we had this square root of minus c over qi, right? Something like this. If this is, you know, unless c over qi is negative, this is imaginary, right? So mod phi equal to imaginary, right? That basically means that we are switching on complex valid fields, right? Not a real value. So that's not a physical solution. Okay, so now given this, one can construct psi. I'll not write it down in detail, but you can just follow the standard algorithm to write down psi 3. Okay. And then we can check the condition for xn to next one. And here one finds the possible obstruction. Okay, again you have to check for all p. From two different p's. One, if I remember correctly, is e to the minus pi. Okay, this is one. This is, you can say that this is a trace of a capital. The other one is basically C. This basically you can think of this as a zero momentum delay. Okay, in the minus one. Okay, this becomes 60 del square C in the zero picture, but in the minus one picture it is the C. Anyway, so net upshot is that for both of these choices of p, one finds that the beta equal to 0 vacuum doesn't satisfy the consistency, right? Doesn't obstruct. Okay, the beta equal to 0 vacuum basically runs into obstruction because this matrix element is non-zero. But the beta equal to plus minus the beta not vacuum, by okay, both of these give 0 contribution for the beta equal to plus minus. Yeah, but you have to choose beta naught precisely to be what we determine at this level. So Okay, for arbitrary beta it doesn't cancel, right? Because these contributions combine terms from various genera. Is this clear? So here the beta equal to 0 solution goes away. And beta equal to plus minus beta now. So, okay, so this is what shows that the shifted vacuum, okay, continues to survive to the next order, but the quadratic vacuum is no longer stable. Okay, so now we can explicitly check if this new vacuum is personal. Okay, quadratic vacuum, we have seen that at one loop, at k-1, supersymmetry gets broken because that two-point function that you have to calculate doesn't have supersymmetry. But what about the new vacuum? So let me remind you what we have to calculate. So simply restoration. So basically what you had seen is that the supersymmetry whether supersymmetry is broken or not depending on calculating the two point function. Okay. Where this was the supersymmetry generator, okay, zero total supersymmetry generator, and this was the conjugate of the zero momentum negation, right, which is a possible candidate for mode shift. So these are rows number 1, this is rows number 3. So this we have calculated in the unshifted vacuum, in the quadratic vacuum, and found that this is non-zero, so its supersymmetry is broken. Now we have to recalculate this in the shifted vacuum, which basically means that we have, of course, this original contribution is very much there, but now we have to add additional terms to this two-point function, which comes from coupling to the vacuum. Okay, because see, all the new vortices that we get in the string field theory are the old vortices already which are there, plus some additional terms which are proportional to psi classical. Okay. So you basically take into account the effect of the psi classical and recompute this, right? So it will get contribution from original. Plus gamma 2 due to background. Due to this one, of course, knows nothing about beta, beta naught. This one knows about beta naught, right? Because what psi classical you are switching on depends on beta naught. And what one finds that this is 0 precisely for beta naught equals like minus 6 comma 2 over beta naught. That's what we have here, right? Beta naught is square root of minus 6 comma 2 from this. So what I'll find is precisely when you say beta equal to this value, these two terms will get cancelled. Okay, the calculation is straightforward, but I'll not describe it. Okay, it's just we have to basically what you do is that you take the expression for the new gamma 2 and massage various terms in that contribution to write everything in terms of some amplitude in the quadratic. That's the main trick here, that you take any amplitude in a shifted background, anything that you calculate in a shifted background, and try to rewrite it as some amplitude in the quantumated background, which you can compute. That is directly computable from all shift analysis. But the result is something that you get in the shifted background. Pardon?
What was my
R2 original? Yeah, the new term now, you get a beta dependent contribution, yeah? And when you choose beta equal to this ratio, then you find that that exactly cancels. So this indicates the supersymmetry is restored at least to this order. Okay, once you know what in the shifted value. But you can also try to check this by looking for Bose form degeneracy. So recall that one of the things that we have to calculate it, okay, that was yesterday, finished the computation, is a mass square, right? Renormalized mass square of that particular theorem. Okay. That new star, but that you can also think of as mass of the new one. Right? Because new one is a real part of the new one. Okay. So we have calculated renormalized mass square of new one. And the way we calculated is that you just looked at the one function of the torus. Because for one loop mass renormalization, that's all you do. Right? You don't have all the subtleties of resumming and so on. Okay. So you have gotten that as gs square times of gamma 2 1. But now there will be additions to it. Because in the presence of the background, there are more quadratic terms in the action. Right? Because once you have switched on psi classical, right, even the tree level, in tree level the coupling starts from cubic and higher, right, than the original action. But once you have shifted psi by psi classical plus something else, chi, right, then a cubic term will give, in general, a psi classical chi chi term, right? A quadratic term will give psi classical chi chi term. So all of these will give a new quadratic term in the action and hence contribute to the mass square. Okay. And by analyzing the terms carefully, what we find is that we get an additional contribution to the mass square, which is of the quadratic term. Okay. So even though we have all four new arts, actually two of them play slightly different role from the other two. These two, okay, just like these two, are appearing because we are trying to compute the mass square of new one. These two are appearing because the shift in the background is proportional to new one. Okay, if you have some other field, right, say PP, then these would have been PP, these would have been PP, these would still be new one. Anyway, so we know what beta is, right? This is beta naught. So we know what beta naught is. So you can substitute and compute. Pardon. Basically, these two terms actually are proportional to each other. Because beta naught square is again, which is a factor of 6, it's gamma 2 over gamma 4. Minus, yeah, something like that, because this is minus 3, yeah. then the minus, this is minus, so minus 3, that gives minus 2. Okay. Now we have to compare this to the formulas. Now earlier we had argued that the formulas cannot have a mass, the mass degenerate, because here it says that the scalar mass square is more from dGa square. So mass is proportional to Gs. Okay. And for the fermions, the loop corrections or quantum corrections directly calculate the mass and not mass square. Okay. And in the water body vacuum, there is no way you can get a mass of order Gs. Okay. All corrections start at order Gs square. Okay. But now that argument is not valid anymore because I classical is of order Gs. Right? So the fermion can in principle pick up a mass just from the background. Okay, just take the three-level contribution, three-level action, and switch on the background, the formula can become mass. Is this okay? But for formulas, it turns out that calculating the mass is somewhat tricky. And this brings us to our starting one. For the bosons, we said that the mass square calculation just reduces to two part functions. Okay? Because if we just, at least a leading contribution to the mass square, if we can identify the two part function, okay, that gives the mass square. Okay? That requires, of course, standard form of the action, like m square phi square. Okay? And that is possible for the bosons, even though we have introduced a psi tilde field for both formulas and bosons. In the round Lemoussoir sector, you can just set psi tilde equal to sum. Okay, that's a perfectly consistent action because G is identity. Okay? So psi tilde, if you set psi tilde equal to sum, you get a perfectly gauge invariant action in the Lemoussoir sector and you can order it. But for formulas, we have seen that that's not possible. Right? That's why you introduce psi tilde in the first place. So to identify the mass by looking at the quadratic part of the action is tricky because psi tilde is has double, I mean once you include psi tilde is double the number of fields, say. So the action has double the number of fields and it's hard to see, examine the spectrum. So the way one goes about computing a formula mass, okay, is what I described earlier, that namely, we simply construct the order qv hat. Qv hat was qv plus, I think it was gp, okay, some form like this, and k on a y is in sum over n. So the order gs itself quite simple is gs times beta beta I think log
psi-classical
is the shift, yes. Psi-classical is beta gb1. Psi-classical
is beta gb1
plus I. So here the idea is that you just directly try to solve for this. Uv on some state A, the beta gs. Okay, this is the harmonic equation of motion. Sorry, beta gs g. And then we find condition on momentum k for which this is the solution. okay, and try to reinterpret the equation as S plus minus A on something equal. Okay, so this is basically determinism.
So we read off the mass from the on-shell condition.
From on-shell condition.
Not direction.
That's right. So we derive the equation of motion, okay, try to derive the on-shell condition by solving this equation. Okay. Again, the on-shell, if you can solve this equation iteratively, okay, to this order, the abstraction will come by taking matrix elements of physical states. Right? You take all states at that mass level, then they are matrix element. It's the same procedure that I described, right? That you can set up this problem of solving the on-shell condition, okay, in a way which always reduces to higher dimensional matrix. Right? So you follow the same algorithm, right? Reduce it to finite dimensional matrix equation. And what you find is that that finite dimensional matrix equation can be rewritten as k slash minus m equal on some vector equal to 0. And that m is basically related to this vector space. Okay, in the absence of this correction, because k slash on this equal to 0, the formulas are lossless. So by comparing what you get from here with an equation of this sort, you can read out what it is. Okay. And then we find that this n is exactly what we have got. Okay, that's the way one shows that bosons and formulas in fact are generated. Okay, which is not a surprise because we have already argued that supersymmetry is restored. So just from the general supersymmetric Bayer entities, one can prove that bosons and formulas must be generated. But this is an explicit effect. But let me emphasize again that reading out the formula mass is much trickier than the bosonic mass, even to this order, right? Even to order gx. Right? You cannot simply calculate a two-point function and try to read out the formula mass. Okay? Because it's actually because of the fact that in the formulas, right, that what couples to psi is psi theta. Okay? So it's not a two-point function of the same physical. Okay, so I think maybe I'll stop here. So this is basically the summary of what we can do here with this.
Can you just briefly talk about the supersymmetric word identities and how to get them from this formula?
Yeah, so basically, so normal word identities are, so there are two kinds of word identities you can get. One is when, say, not in normal, say, when QB. So, when one of the external states is QB lambda, then you know that if all the other external states are physical, then the result is 0. Right? If all the other states are not physical, then the result can be expressed as sum of terms or QB acts on those external states. Right? Because you just take BRC contour and move it around. Here, we can ask what is the analog of that statement, because now physical state condition on the external states are changed. Right? It's not to be on psi anymore, right? So the earlier argument that if you insert a QB lambda, okay, on one of the external states, then it gives you zero answer for physical external states, right? Is not valid anymore because external states don't satisfy QB on them equal to 0. They satisfy QB hat on them equal to 0. So what one can show in this supersymmetric covariant entities is that the covariant entities take a slightly different form. You start, so what you show is that if you take an amplitude, okay, one of the external states, QB hat lambda, okay, because QB hat squares to 0, so this is by construction a physical state. So if you consider an amplitude gamma, QB hat lambda, and other states say phi1, phi n, then starting with the word identities starting with the gauge impedance of the one way action. Once I manipulate that to show that this is given by sum of terms, which is also from gamma lambda, we have phi 1 phi 2 plus an identity that one can do, and this shows that if all the external states are physical, then if qv had phi 1 equal to 0, so now we are not demanding qv phi equal to 0, but qv had phi equal to 0, right? This is the external state of a function. Then again, inserting qv had lambda, okay, makes there is a transition. Okay, so this is the partial of supra-expected quadrant theorem, which basically says that the pure gauge states decouple, but now it decouples from an amplitude where the external states are replaced, external realist infinite vortex of quadrants are replaced by the this modified vortex of quadrants, okay, which are this modified realist infinite, right? In particular, they don't satisfy that L0 plus equal to 0, right? Because their masses can get renormalized. And once the masses are renormalized, the realist inference doesn't require L0 plus equal to 0, but L0 plus equal to something which is given by quantum mechanics. So this basically, as I said, you can prove using the gauge invariance of the one-way action. Right? So from there, you get some identity among the one-way vortices, right? And then you use the fact that the full amplitude is constructed after all using one-way vortices joined by properties. So then by manipulating those gauge impedance conditions, you can arrive at this condition.
So we have to use that identity of the...
You have to use that?
The identity we have from the forms.
Exactly, yeah. So you have to use an identity, yeah. Okay, that's why qv acts on the square bracket, right? Or Cauchy bracket, how it distributes among various other things. So this is one thing. The other aspect, okay, which is that if okay, so now suppose I have a global symmetry. Okay, suppose lambda is a global symmetry. Global symmetry generator means that qv hat lambda is 0. Right? Now, if qv hat lambda is 0, and if all the external states are physical, then this quadrant is somewhat useless, right? Because the left hand side is 0 because qv hat lambda is 0. The right hand side is 0 because this qv hat phi is also 0. Right? So, while this quadrant is true, but it's useless because it's just giving you 0 equal. So when you have a global symmetry, there is a different way of manipulating these diagrams, okay, which gives the variant in a slightly different form. That if qv hat lambda equal to 0, then what one can show is that the following is true. These are all 1 pi, all constructed using 1. Right? That in fact, all throughout this, we have been using the 1 pi construction. Right? We never went back to the original game. So, this is the analog of a global identity. Right? So, how does a global person go? Global identities look like? Right? If you have a gauge invariance, for example, somewhere a global state, right? Then it says that if you change the entries one at a time by the dual symmetric transformation, the results will vanish. Gamma of delta phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, etc. plus gamma of phi 1, delta phi 2, phi 3, etc. and so on. These should add up to 0. Right? Because the root will change. When you change all the fields by that inference from a global symmetric transformation, the result should be 0. So this version of the Warren entity, again you can prove from the same general properties of the 1 to f axis, but using a somewhat different language. So this is the IR of the global symmetry, in particular supersymmetry identities. And one consequence of this kind of identity you can show is that the is a degeneracy between bosons and quarks. Okay, what you can show that for every, so basically it comes from the fact that if we have A which satisfies Q, we have A equal to 0, then U be hat on lambda U is also zero. Okay, again roughly there are, I mean, not an like a more careful expression. So what does it mean? Suppose A is a state of certain momentum, carrying certain momentum, and you have found a state which satisfies U be hat equal to zero. That's an all shell state, right? Now what this is saying, lambda carries zero momentum, right? So lambda A, okay, if this is bosonic, this will be formulaic, right? So lambda A is a formulaic state, zero momentum, and it satisfies U behavior on this equal to zero, right? So for every momentum for which there is an on-shell bosonic state, there is also an on-shell formulaic state, and vice versa. So this is the statement of Bose-Fermi degenerates, right? If at a given momentum there is a bosonic state, it satisfies on-shell condition. There is also a formulaic state that satisfies also. So this way you can use, once you have an unbroken global supersymmetry. See, all of these of course hinge on this decided. That once you have an unbroken global supersymmetry, every lambda would satisfy this. You can show that for every linearized solution to the linearized equation supposed in the Ramonsoir sector, there is a solution in the Ramon sector carrying exactly the same and vice versa. So these are the two ways you can make use of supersymmetric wire identities. One is simply that the pure gauge state should be coupled, okay, that is standard gauge equations. Okay. But other one is that if you have unbroken global supersymmetry, then it implies certain relationship between the Green's functions, okay, including the degeneracy between.